الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على خير خلق الله أجمعين، نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وعلى أصحابه وآله وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، we praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى abundantly, and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to his family, his companions, his wives, and all those who follow them on their righteous path until the day of recompense. It is very saddening when a Muslim lacks knowledge or is misinformed regarding any aspect of the deen. It's sad when most people among the followers of Islam really don't know Islam. And you get sometimes some very, very outlandish questions which indicate the lack of knowledge which is very much prevalent among the masses. And that is contrary to the condition of our righteous predecessors who were knowledgeable. And nevertheless, even though it's sad that some people or many people lack knowledge concerning some aspects of the deen, some things we simply cannot afford to be ignorant of. There are some things, if I may say, which you can afford to be ignorant. Not saying it's okay to be ignorant, but you can afford. As in, it does not jeopardize your belief system. It doesn't take you outside the pales of Islam. It doesn't put you, you know, in a dangerous zone. It's bad, but it is not bad, very bad. But there are things which, if you actually don't know, or you misunderstand, or you misinterpret, will exclude you from being an adherent to this religion. It constitutes disbelief and heresy. Now, there's an aspect of our deen which the scholars and the people of da'wah are the ones who know most about, the most concerning this issue. And they know how much the Muslims suffer. Why? The scholars, which we're not from, they're somewhere way higher than what we're trying to be at. And the people of da'wah are the ones who can identify the problems which the Muslims are facing, because they are the ones who are in contact with the masses all the time. And so sometimes people think one issue is a problem while it's really not. And sometimes they think that this is not an issue while it really is. And this issue we'll be discussing today is a classical example of something which many people don't understand while they think that they actually understand. And we will get some examples so this could become clear. Now, this aspect of our deen, which most disbelievers don't understand, in fact, it's fair to say, all disbelievers misunderstand, and worse than that, many, many, many Muslims misunderstand as well. The problem, however, is that this aspect is one of the pillars of Iman. Ouch. I mean, you can, you know, you can be ignorant of some minor fiqh issue. You know, you don't know what the sunnah is concerning this or that. طيب. But when it's one of the pillars of Iman, you know you're in trouble. And before I tell you what it is, let me see if you can guess. Which pillar of the pillars of Iman do you think people actually have a major misunderstanding concerning? Qadr. Good. Now, before we deal with Qadr, do I have a choice? You will see. I mean, I have a choice, yes. You have a choice. I mean, I'm giving you the title of the lecture. Don't think I'm asking you now if I have a choice. Obviously, I have a choice. Otherwise, I wouldn't speak. And because some people will say that I don't have a choice. As you will see later on in the lecture, according to some, I'm being forced to speak because Allah decreed it. But before we go into that, let me ask you some more questions. Is or are the pillars of Iman something which is optional or obligatory to believe in? Can you believe in some and reject some? Rejecting one means rejecting all. And we have many, many, many evidences for that in the Quran and the Sunnah, sufficient to quote two. When Allah Azza wa Jal wanted to tell us about the people of Nuh, He said, كَذَّبَتْ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. The people of Nuh belied the messengers. And we know that Nuh was the first messenger. There were none other than him. Adam was a prophet. Nuh was the first messenger. You can pretty much say there's an agreement concerning that. So when Allah said that they belied the messengers, it means because of their denial of Nuh, they have automatically denied everyone else. Allah says in Surah An-Nisa, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَيُرِيدُونَ أَن يُفَرِّقُوا بَيْنَ اللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَيَقُولُونَ نُؤْمِنُ بِبَعْضٍ وَنَكْفُرُ بِبَعْضٍ وَيُرِيدُونَ أَن يَتَّخِذُوا بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ سَبِيلًا أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ حَقًّا. Verily those who disbelieve in Allah and His messengers, and they want to make a distinction between Allah and His messengers by saying, we will believe in some and disbelieve in some. We will accept such and such and such, but we will not accept such and such. Then Allah said, and they want to take a path, this kind of path in between. We neither reject all, nor do we believe all. Allah said, those are the disbelievers, haqqan, in truth. Now, believe in the messengers. Belief in the messengers is one of the pillars of Iman. Those who concerning one of the pillars wanted to divide within it, Allah said these are the disbelievers in truth, let alone those who want to actually reject a whole pillar. If they rejected the whole pillar of messengers, they would be kuffar. They actually rejected part of it, they still became kuffar. So we learn from this that the faith is one entity. The pillars of Iman are a single entity. Either you pick up the whole thing or you drop the whole thing. You can't chop it up into pieces, keep some and leave some. Very important to understand. So if someone doesn't believe in Qadr, he has actually disbelieved in one of the pillars of faith. And if you miss any of the pillars of faith, you're no longer a believer. So we have a very serious issue here, which is a fine line between belief and disbelief. Mind you, we have many narrations from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam which actually speak about people from this ummah belying Qadr and declaring them as Majus. Majus, Magians. The Majus, the fire worshippers. Those who claim that Satan, he has his own creation. Satan created evil, so it's his own creation. What does that mean? That means there's another creator with Allah. When you attribute creation of evil to Iblis, then you have made Iblis a creator along with Allah, which is actually kufr and shirk. These are the Majus. Those who belie in Qadr, they fall into the same trap. Very serious subject matter. Now, people have gone astray in regards to Qadr from way back. In fact, it was the same excuse given by the mushrikeen. The mushrikeen of Quraysh had said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah said, سَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا لَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا أَشْرَكْنَا وَلَا أَبَاؤُنَا وَلَا حَرَّمْنَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ كَذَلِكَ كَذَّبَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. They said, had Allah willed, we would have never associated partners with Him, nor would have our forefathers, nor would we have made anything forbidden. So this was their claim. We will see the answer of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah said, such belied those who came before them. So Allah said that they're belying. They're lying when they claim that they're using Qadr as an excuse, which is the main issue. Someone disobeys Allah, and if you tell him why, he says, Ya akhi, the Qadr of Allah. You're going to blame me for what Allah decreed for me? If Allah decreed, I wouldn't have sinned. So this kind of approach and mentality is the one that we will be addressing. And the other extreme one, which says that everything you're doing is forced upon you by Allah because Allah decreed it. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are where? In between, as in everything else. And we will see what that exactly means. Now, there are two groups among the followers of Islam, if we can still call them that. It's not our job to now disqualify them, even though some of them are disqualified, who went astray in regards to Qadr. And they're known as Al-Qadariya and Al-Jabariya. Okay, familiarize yourself with these terms. because the Arabic terminology is an element or a fundamental factor in da'wah. You need to be familiar with Arabic words. It's nice to have some English vocabulary here and there, but ultimately what is most important is the Arabic vocabulary, because it is what it was revealed, and it is the most accurate depiction of meanings. English is nice, but it doesn't do the job. Arabic is a whole other thing, and we will see what that means in a little bit. Qadariya and Jabariya. Now, believe it or not, these people, these two groups, were actually united in terms of the principle. Meaning they both believed in the same principle. That principle is, whatever Allah willed, it means Allah loves. So they made the will of Allah synonymous with Allah's love. Anything which Allah willed, anything which Allah decreed, anything which happens, it must be beloved to Allah, otherwise Allah wouldn't have let it happen. So they agreed that this is a fundamental principle for them. Anything that happens must be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now they agreed on that. Now when the results came, they became Al-Qadariya and Al-Jabariya. What are the results? The results is there's kufr in this world. There's shirk in this world. There's rape. There's adultery. There's alcoholism. There's drug consumption. There's smokers. And the list goes on of evil things which exist. So, the Jabariya said, well, if this happens, it means Allah loves it. So one of them will actually be engaging in that sin while he believes that he's doing what Allah loves. Because Allah will that these things happen. So they became Al-Jabariya, which basically say you're like a feather in the wind. You have absolutely no choice. You have no choice in what is happening. Which means there's no point for you really to do ibadah. What is the point of you saying ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim if you're just like a feather in the wind? If you have no say in anything. That's the deviance. The Qadariya, they thought they were more intelligent. They said, look, it's impossible that Allah loves kufr, shirk, you know, all these evil things. Then it must mean that you do them on your own. It is not something which Allah created. So now they've committed shirk. They try to run away from one thing. They fell into you being the creator of your own actions. So now we have billions of creators with Allah. That sounds like Hinduism. In their misunderstanding of their God and, you know, the subdivisions. So they say that, and now there are levels, the Qadariya. Some of them say Allah does not know what you will do. He doesn't know it. After you do it, Allah finds out. Crazy stuff. The ones who are less deviant, they say, no, Allah knows, but Allah gave you many options. He gave you like a bunch of options, and he only knows about what you choose. He knows the possibilities, in other words, but he doesn't know what you will choose until you choose it. And this is why you have to be very careful who you listen to. You know, we avoid as much as possible to mention people as long as they are upon the sunnah. Any brother in Islam who's given da'wah, who's from Ahl Sunnah, upon the aqidah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the methodology of the righteous predecessors, we love, honor, and respect. Even if they make mistakes, you know, everybody makes mistakes. But when it comes to issues or individuals who are not within this margin, who are not in that zone, then it becomes necessary that it is brought to the Muslims' attention so that they will know. For instance, one of our brothers, whom we ask Allah to rectify his condition, Shabir Ali. Some of you may know him, some of you may not. He's involved in debating with the Christians and different people, mainly Christians. He debates with Christians. And he's an excellent debater. I mean, when he, you know, he deals with things in a very professional way, if I may say. Nevertheless, he has a major issue in this regard, in regards of Qadr. So this is why not every time you find a good speaker, you get excited. Okay, and you start saying, okay, then everything else goes. No, you must be careful. Because some people may be eloquent, or they may be skillful in one way, and they will take you to Jahannam on the other side of the coin. So you have to be familiar. That's why the most important thing before you start labeling and dealing with these individuals is you gain knowledge. When you know, then you know when you send something wrong, when someone says something wrong, you're able to, you evaluate, you analyze, and you already make a judgment. If you don't know, you'll be a follower. So once you like someone, you usually take everything which he says. Not good. Because we make mistakes. That's why it is important that you don't depend on speakers. You learn yourself. So when speakers speak, you're able to actually, you know, scrutinize and evaluate and make a distinction between the truth and the falsehood. Because no one will give you the truth 100%. This is the messengers. And no one is perfect after the messengers. Not the 40 imams, not the sahaba, no one that came after. Everyone is prone to error. Of course, some are more, it's more likely they will commit a mistake than others. Like the scholars are the least, for example. And the less knowledge you have, the more possibility for you to make mistakes. The bottom line is, that individual, if you are interested in debate, and you want to listen to the debate, then make sure that you don't fall into some of his issues of rejecting authentic narrations in Bukhari and Muslim, if they don't agree with the mind. You know, because to him the science of hadith is something that is not really reliable, that's dangerous. The issue of qadar, that's dangerous. Be careful. Be careful and don't go astray in this regard. So the Qadariyya then they say that basically Allah knows about the possibilities, but He does not know about the actions. He does not know that you will do what you will do. Which means that Allah lacks knowledge. And which means that you have a very much independent will, completely independent. And if this is the case, then how do you understand? وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. You don't will until Allah wills. So the way we understand this ayah is that there's the Mashiach of Allah and there's the Mashiach of the creation of Allah. Now Allah gave us the free will, so that you're not forced to do anything, but that free will is conditional to the will of Allah, who is most just, most wise, most merciful. And if we understand that, our problem is over. The issue with these individuals is that they have not appraised Allah with true appraisal. They have not really understood the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal. We cannot as Muslims think evil, anything evil of Allah. And frankly speaking, when you say Allah created you and He imposed on you to commit sins, then He will put you in Jahannam for that, this is wrong. You're accusing Allah of being unjust and of oppressing you and wronging His creation. And this is kufr. And if you believe that you do things which Allah doesn't know and that you have this kind of free will, that's also bad thought about Allah. You have not understood the greatness and the majesty of Allah Azza wa Jal. So we have to understand things in the right context. Because if you don't understand things in the right context, you will go astray, with or without a text. Now listen to this. Some people, if a calamity befalls them, they do what? What do they do? The typical disbeliever, the average disbeliever, if news come to him that, you know, five of his family members died in a car accident, all of them were nice people, as they say, giving charity, they were helping the community, they helped build the church, blah, blah, blah. What is the average response of the disbeliever? No one knows? Maybe you haven't mixed with them enough. Yeah. Why? These nice bunch of people. And it's funny, you know, Jimmy Swaggart, speaking of Jimmy Swaggart, somebody had made it, you know, we mentioned him in one of the lectures. You will surely remember what I'm telling you. So somebody's Allah Khair made a very nice thing. Because we were speaking about how he's one of those who lied against Allah, Musrif Kadhab, and how Allah exposed him multiple times. So someone actually made a video where they would mention what I said about him, and they will show clips which they have from him, from the, you know, from the news about his lies and what have you. It was really funny. So on, you know, when you watch YouTube on the right side, usually you get a bunch of evil options, and sometimes they're good, but usually things which you probably don't want to watch. Nevertheless, there was another video of him, and I, out of curiosity, I wanted to check out what he has to say. This is a recent one. And now this is him. Jimmy Swaggart was with his congregation. You know, he looks like he's 500 years old, still trying to look like a young man. And he's addressing them. I don't know what he's saying to them, you know, with his usual act. So while he's there, someone comes and he whispers to him that some other, you know, Christian propagator, you know, missionary guy died while he's addressing the people. So he wanted to take a pause, you know, to pray, supposedly to God to have mercy on this man. And what this is now, this is the religious figure. He said, God, you know, something in the name of Jesus, you know, all this, you know, the acting. They're very professional in acting. You think he's a big believer in the shayateen. And he is. He said, I don't know why you have decided to take, you know, or I don't know why you've taken the soul of such and such person. But, you know, now that you've taken the soul, then, you know, we ask you to have mercy on him and blah, blah, blah. Hey, the first thing he did, he was sitting there now supposedly speaking to God. What are you doing? How could you? This man was working for Christianity. What are you doing taking the soul? This is the mentality which the people have. When calamity befalls them, they actually want to point fingers, if we may say, you know, against Allah and say, what are you doing? And subhanAllah, this is ajeeb, ya Shaykh, ajeeb for someone to have the audacity to tell the one who created him, you know, what are you doing? And Allah had taught us in the Quran and He disciplined us very well. لَا يُسْأَلُ عَمَّا يَفْعَلُ وَهُمْ يُسْأَلُونَ He is not questioned about anything which he does. We are the ones who will be questioned. فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ He does whatever he wants. فَعَال يعني He does whatever, whenever, however. Nobody has any business with that. But we Muslims believe in Allah. When Allah does what he does it with His mercy, with His justice, with His compassion, with His love, with all the names and attributes of Allah. We never think of Allah independent of these names and attributes. Otherwise, why did Allah reveal them? And why did the Prophet ﷺ say Allah has 99 names, whosoever, which we know of, Allah has more, but the ones which were revealed, 99, whosoever encompasses them will enter Jannah, which means you know Allah according to them and you believe in Allah according to them, which means you never assume anything evil about Allah Azza wa Jal. So we need to know our limits. Now there are three different dimensions when it comes to the belief in Qadr. Number one, or we mentioned number one, which is no one has the right to accuse Allah of anything evil. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ Number two, we must refer to the Quran and the Sunnah. According to who? To the Sufis? You will go to Jahannam. I'm telling you, bro. You believe in the Quran and the Sunnah according to the Sufis, you're not really practicing Islam. You're practicing something else which they have invented. Now we know they are at different levels. There may be some, you know, moderate, light, easygoing Sufis. You know, you're not too far from the truth. You're still far from the truth, but not too far. But if you're a total Sufi, total Ash'ari, total Maturidi, total, you know, Mu'tazili, total Shi'i, total whatever, you are not upon the deen which Allah revealed. And this is a problem. Everybody wants to understand the Quran and the Sunnah in their own invented ways. It doesn't work. It just doesn't work. You cannot go against the early generations because Allah gave them certain things and certain qualities and certain privileges and He praised them in ways which we cannot even dream about. All we can see is وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ And the only thing we get, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُهُمْ Those who follow them. The best we can do is follow them. You can never be with them. You can never be like them. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Him. Allah is even mentioning to you that they are pleased with Him. Does Allah need them to be pleased with Him? No, Allah doesn't need anyone to be pleased with Him. Still He mentioned it out of praise for them. So someone wants to go against all of them and, you know, disregard all of their understanding and think that he and the, you know, 15th century can understand Islam better than they did. Impossible. And once you start developing this kind of ideology, you are already on the wrong path. So if you go back to the statements of the Sahaba, and this issue you can find in many different books. I advise you to get the book of Al-Aqidah Al-Wasitiyah. I will discuss it later, inshallah. This issue of Qadr has been discussed by Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah extensively. You go back and read. I cannot quote everything here. What the Sahaba said concerning these issues. What the Tabi'een said, what the Imam said, and you will be upon clarity. You start dealing with the philosophers and the rationalists and all these people, wallah, you will get confused. They will confuse you. You will not understand what to believe concerning the Qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. Even though when Jibreel came and asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about Iman, he said, وَأَن تُؤْمِنَ بِالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ. You must believe in Qadr, the good and the bad thereof. You must believe in it according to the Quran and the Sunnah and the understanding of the righteous predecessors. Lastly, is know your limits. Know your limits. At the end of the day, each one of us has been given a brain. And we all know that our brains are not identical. If we were to have an IQ, you know, test right now, Allahu a'lam what the results would be, but we'll have huge variation. You know, some of us may not even pass, and others may appear to be intelligent, and the list goes on. The idea is, the mind has its limits. If you fail to understand something, then let us understand that this is a deficiency in our intellect. Let us not, you know, go against the teachings of Islam because we fail to understand something. If you don't understand, believe and submit to Allah. But you have to accept the Quran and the Sunnah face value. That's the ultimate thing. Now, let me tell you something. The belief in Qadr has four different aspects that you have to believe in. The Qadr basically comprises of four different matters. First, everything was created by Qadr. Inna kulla shay'in khalaqnahu bi Qadr. Allah says, really, everything we have created with Qadr. Allah created everything with Qadr. Qadr now can be translated in many different ways. Some say it's decree, the decree of Allah. And some say it's the predestination. And some say it's the preordainment. Whatever. The terms is not an issue. Whatever term you prefer to use, predestiny, predestination, all of them are actually close. Decree has more meanings because there's a royal decree, as in like an announcement. So that some terms actually entertain multiple meanings. Usually you try to avoid terms that have multiple meanings when you're addressing an audience of non-Muslims in particular, so that they will not think about something else. You know, you try to use words that are more precise so that the message is absolutely delivered. Because you say decree, and you know, decree has many meanings. Predestination, usually you're still, you know, you're in around the same kind of zone. You're in the same area. You don't go astray. Now, we said you have to believe in Qadr. We quoted the hadith of Jibreel. The first aspect of belief in Qadr is al-ilm, Allah's knowledge. You must believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge encompasses everything. Inna Allah bi kulli shay'in alim. The ayah could have said, Inna Allah alimun bi kulli shay'. But the ayah says, Inna Allah bi kulli shay'in alim. There's a reason for that in the Arabic language. This is called sighatul hasr. Just like you say, Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in, you don't say, Na'buduka wahdak wa nasta'inu bik. Why do you say that? Why did Allah reveal that? Because of exclusivity. Exclusivity. When you say Iyaka na'bud, meaning we worship none but you. So the stronger meaning is to say Inna Allah bi kulli shay'in. Allah concerning everything is all knowledgeable. This makes it stronger than saying Inna Allah alimun bi kulli shay'. Because it is given when the that which is supposed to be delayed in the sentence is put forth, it indicates importance and exclusivity. So Allah knows everything. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَحَاطَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا. Allah has encompassed everything in knowledge subhanahu wa ta'ala. Listen to this hadith from Ali radiallahu anhu wa ardah. He was sitting, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day was sitting with a wooden stick in his hand with which he was scratching the ground. Okay? Wooden stick, scratching the ground. He raised his head and said, there is none of you but has his place assigned either in the fire or in paradise. Listen, O Muslims, and understand. Now this is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying to the Sahaba, none of you is an exception, except that his place has already been determined in paradise or in hell. It's already been assigned. They said now, O Messenger of Allah, why should we carry on doing good deeds then? Shall we depend on Al-Qadr and give up work? This is the natural reaction. If it's already been decreed, then What's the point of working? If Allah decreed I'm going to Jannah, I don't have to do good deeds. Because why? The Qadr is going to take me there. You understand? And if I've been decreed to go to Jahannam, then what are the good deeds going to do? Because I can't go against the Qadr, then the Qadr will take me to Jahannam. There's no point in doing good deeds. So the human being say, I might as well have fun. If I'm going to do good deeds now and go to Jahannam later, if I'm going to Jahannam anyways, then if I can't get the dunya and the akhirah, let me get the dunya. Since the akhirah is gone. Human mentality. You're smiling because you know this is what the person would think. So this is the reaction of the Sahaba. Subhanallah. Here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches them and teaches us his ummah something else. Listen to what he said. He said, no. And once he says no, it means no. And you don't come afterwards and say anything else. You don't have the right. You don't have the authority. You don't have, I don't care what you want to call it, to come and contradict the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So even if you fail to understand, when he said to the Sahaba, don't depend on Qadr, no means no. Meaning you can't do that either. Look what he said. He said, no, but carry on doing good deeds. For everyone will find easy to do. He will be facilitated to that which he was created for. Then he recited the ayat, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلَ وَاسْتَغْنَى وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْعُسْرَى. As for he who gives and keeps his duty to Allah and fears Him and believes in the Husna, which is the Tawheed, the righteousness, the Deen of Islam, we will make smooth for him the path of ease. On the other hand, if the one who belies and is miserly and doesn't give, and he denies al-husna, then we will facilitate for him, we will make smooth for him the path of lack of facilitation. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is teaching us that, you know, the Prophet ﷺ is teaching us Allah already taught us that you do what you have to do and you will be facilitated to that. But Allah still said, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى. You have to give, you have to have taqwa of Allah for you to be facilitated towards that. You can't be, you know, lazy and expect to make it there. It doesn't work this way. Now, Allah knew that Iblis would disobey, didn't he? Did Allah know that Iblis would disobey or not? He knew. And that he would not prostrate to Adam as Allah commanded him. The angels didn't know. And so when they said to Allah, you know, when they questioned Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not in the sense as many people think, they say, you know, the angels, how could the angels ask Allah, question Allah? This is not how the scholars understand it. It is not someone who is contradicting the command of Allah. It was, they're trying to understand the wisdom behind it. And if you read the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, if you don't read the tafsir, you may misunderstand the ayah. They were not saying, you know, how do you do this, as in they're accusing Allah of lack of judgment. Otherwise, they would have been like Iblis. It was merely trying to understand that Allah taught them, إِنِّي أَعْلَمْ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. I know that which you don't know. Meaning, Allah knew that Iblis is going to disobey. That's the wisdom behind it. And Allah Azza wa Jal did this according to His wisdom. Otherwise, there will be no test. There will be no testing. So this is what we need to understand. Some people complain about evil. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that khayr, all khayr, is in the hands of Allah. Wa sharru laysa ilayk. Please understand, evil is not attributed to Allah. You understand? You say Iblis. Iblis is evil. And Allah created Iblis, didn't He? That means that Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator of evil. We say, no. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that evil is not attributed to Allah. Nothing is really pure evil, believe it or not. In the creation of Iblis, there's good. Can anyone answer why? Why is there good in the creation of Iblis? What do you think?
Because without the attribution of bad, there is no good.
Indeed, if Iblis wasn't there for you to disobey him, you wouldn't earn Jannah. In the existence of, in the creation of Allah, they make evil. This evil makes you appreciate and identify and live according to good. Because through opposites, things become clear. When you wouldn't know what black is until you see white, you wouldn't know what white until you see black. That variation is the one that makes you understand the difference between the two. I'm not speaking about people, by the way. I'm speaking about, you know, clothes. Just in case somebody think we're propagating any form of racism. We know that racism is not part of Islam. Never been and never will be. So, honestly, there isn't such thing as evil being attributed to Allah. Very dangerous and, a trap that people fall into. Because Allah says, "Min sharri ma khalaq." Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq. Say, I seek refuge with the Lord of the daybreak. From the evil of that which He created. You say death. What good is there in death? Death is evil. We say, how many people repent to Allah when other people die? How many people enter Jannah because of the death of other people? Isn't there good in that? If anything you mention, anything you bring, which you say is pure evil, we will be able to give you goodness in that and show you the goodness in that. So there's no such thing as pure evil, brothers and sisters in Islam. Allah created things, and because of the existence of this evil, the evil comes from the creation of the people, meaning from the byproduct of the people's actions. It is not attributed to Allah in the ultimate sense. We learn this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the first thing is Allah knows everything. Allah knows everything, meaning Allah knew that there will be iman and there will be kufr and there will be shirk, and everything is known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is part of the ultimate knowledge of Allah Azza wa Jal that no one shares with Him. Not the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and no one else afterwards. Now, the second aspect of our belief in Qadr is what? Al-Kitaba. Al-Kitaba. Kitaba is actually the writings. The writings. And that is on different levels as well. It is not one level. We will deal with them one by one. First, 50,000 years before Allah created the heavens and the earth, Kitaba begin. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the pen. And He said to him, Uktub, write. The pen said, what shall I write, my Lord? He said, write all that which will happen, which will exist until the end of time. And then right then and there, the pen wrote everything which Allah Azza wa Jal commanded it that then. Everything which we're doing, which we people did, which people will do in the future was written. That which we are doing right now, me speaking, you listening, was already written 50,000 years before Allah created the heavens and the earth. Who taught us that? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as-sadiqul masduq. The truthful one who's always believed. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, there are multiple narrations, but before that, let us deal with the ayah. Alam ta'lam anna Allah ya'lamu ma fi as-samawati ma fi as-sama'i wal ard afwan anna Allah ya'lamu ma fi as-sama'i wal ard inna dhalika fi kitab inna dhalika 'ala Allah yasir. Do you not know that Allah knows all that is in the heavens and the earth? Verily, all that is in a book. Verily, this is easy for Allah. This kitab is called Ummul Kitab. وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. With Allah is the mother of the book. The ulama say this is اللوح المحفوظ. بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ فِي لَوْحٍ مَحْفُوظٍ. This preserved tablet, if we may call it that, or preserved, whatever you want to call it. It's sometimes tablet, there's another term, which I can't bring to mind now. Scripture, they use another term for it. عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ. That preserved tablet, or scrolls, there you go, جزاكَ خير. Everything is there. And we will see the relation between that and between dua, and between that and between Laylatul Qadr, because some people say if everything is there, then you know, why do you make dua? And how do things change? We will see when you understand the various levels of the kitabah, then you will be able to understand what happens when. So first we must understand that. The hadith further reinforces that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah had written the ordained measures and due proportions of the creation 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth, and His arsh was on the water. This is according to Sahih Muslim. And the hadith of the pen, which we already mentioned. Now, Abi Hafsa narrated that Ubad ibn Samit, said to his son, "Oh son, you shall not get the true sense of Iman until you know that what has befallen you was not going to miss you, and what missed you was not going to befall you. I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, as soon as Allah created the pen, he commanded it saying, write. It said, what should I write, my Lord? Allah said, write the record of all things to happen till the establishment of the hour. Oh my son, I have heard Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, he who dies believing other than this is not from me. Meaning, is not upon the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was teaching his son, whatever happened to you was meant to happen to you. There's no point in you going, you know, to extremes and grieving and being displeased with the qadr of Allah. There was no way you can avoid it. And whatever missed you, if you wanted to get a job and you didn't get a job, it was never meant for you to get the job. Because if we believe in that, if we don't believe in that, you will live the life of anxiety, the life of stress, the life of worry. When you believe in the qadr of Allah, you relax. You have this kind of peace of mind. Alhamdulillah. Everything is Alhamdulillah. Everything is good from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether you get what you want or you don't get, it's still good because Allah had never decreed it for you anyways. So this is the mentality which we get. So the first is the 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and earth and the preserved scrolls or the preserved tablet. The second is the writing following the creation of Adam. And this is a very important aspect of our deen. Now Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was asked concerning the following ayah. وَإِذَا أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَن تَقُولُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ. And remember when your Lord brought forth from the children of Adam from their loins their seed, or from Adam's loins his offspring, and made them bear witness as to themselves, saying, am I not your Lord? They said, yes, we testify. Then lest you say on the day of resurrection, verily we were unaware of this. Meaning everyone admitted that he was a slave of Allah and that Allah was his Lord. Every human being had done that. This is the fitrah which people try to deny today. Whether the person recalls that or not does not change the facts. Because some people say, I don't remember. You don't have to remember. What you have to do is believe that this actually happened. Meaning Allah made everyone bear witness that He is their Lord. So when they come on the Day of Judgment, no one can come and say, I was unaware of that. Because Allah Azza wa Jal had done that. Now listen to the hadith which explains it. He said, when Allah's Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was asked about the same question, I heard him say, Allah created Adam. And then he passed his right hand and brought forth from it his offspring, saying, I have created these for paradise. And they will do the deeds of the people of Jannah, meaning those who will go to paradise. And then he passed his hand over his back and brought forth from it his offspring, saying, I have created these for hell. And they will do the deeds of the people of the hellfire. Thereupon a man asked, what is the use of doing good deed? If Allah already said these are going to Jannah, and these are going to Jannah, the man asked a question like the Sahaba asked before. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, verily when Allah creates a slave for paradise, He uses him in doing the deeds of the people of paradise until he dies doing them, upon which he will enter paradise. But when He creates a slave for the hellfire, He uses him in doing the deeds of those who will enter hell, until he dies upon doing one of their actions, upon which he will enter the hellfire. This does not mean that Allah Azza wa Jal is imposing that on them, because we have to understand the narrations and the ayat in the light of other narration and ayat. It means, ya akhwan, be careful what kind of life you are leading. If you find yourself, you love Islam, you practice Islam, you're involved in practicing Islam, establishment of salah, doing good deeds, da'wah, inshallah, or Allah is putting you on this path. And if you're sincere, you're not going anywhere else. And if we find ourselves busy with something else, that means that we are choosing to live the life of the people whom Allah decreed to go to the hellfire, decreed they go to the hellfire because of the actions of the people. It is nothing that is imposed. Why? Allah says, قل الحق بربكم فمن شاء فليؤمن ومن شاء فليكفر. If you understand this ayah, your problems are solved. Say, meaning, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say to the people, this is the truth from your Lord. فمن شاء فليؤمن. Whosoever wills, let him believe. وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرُ. And whosoever wills, let him disbelieve. So the free will of belief and disbelief was given to us or not? It was given to us. Allah told us, you want to believe? Believe. If you believe, then Allah will make you lead the life of someone who will go to paradise and will put you there with His justice, mercy, and compassion. And if you don't want to believe, you want to disbelieve, Allah will allow you to disbelieve according to your free will. And He will make you leave the life of someone who chose to go to the hellfire, and He will put you in the hellfire. So this does not mean that it's being imposed on the people, but this is what they will choose. And at the end of the lecture, I will give you an example, inshallah, which will put things in the right order. Al-Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullahu ta'ala, commented and said, many people may understand that this hadith indicates that man has no choice with respect to his deeds, while there are many who think that being from the people of paradise or the people of hell is an arbitrary matter or just sheer luck. It is known that Allah is perfect in His names and attributes. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Then the Shaykh went on to say, it is according to His knowledge, wisdom, and justice that He, the Exalted, chose people for paradise or for hell. He knew that those chosen for paradise will obey Him when they are commanded to do so, and those for hell will disobey when they are commanded to do so. Belief in Iman, belief will take you to Jannah, is your choice. Disbelief will take you to Jahannam, it's your choice. Both are your choice. So you, no one can come and say, because for you to believe that Allah decreed that Fulan will go to Jahannam, then He forced him to live the life of someone who go to Jannah, then put him in Jannah, ya akhwan. Is this something you can believe about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. How do you understand this while you believe Allah Azza wa Jalla saying, وَمَا أَنَا بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ, that Allah never, ever, ever wronged this creation. Allah says, يَا عِبَادِي إِنِّي حَرَّمْتُ الظُّلْمَ عَلَى نَفْسِي وَجَعَلْتُهُ بَيْنَكُمْ مُحَرَّمًا فَلَا تَظَالَمُوا. All my slaves, I've made oppression haram upon myself, and I made it haram amongst you, so don't oppress one another. You will wind up believing about Allah that which will take you outside of Islam. So make sure you don't misunderstand these ahadith and these narrations and these ayat. You have to understand them as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained them. The third level is at-taqdeer al-umuri, which covers the person's lifespan. And you all know the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, the sahih, about the creation of one of us in the womb of his mother. Then the angel is commanded to write four things. What are they? What are the four things? Huh? His rizq, his provision, his lifespan, whether he will be Jannah, wretched, or happy. Everything, and there's one more. You made me forget him. Then it comes in the mudgha for a similar period, and then Allah sends an angel with four words recording the person's provision, his life term, his deeds, and whether he will be shaqiyun aw sa'id, whether he will be wretched or he will be happy. So this is for each person. This is the taqdeer of Allah Azza wa Jal for each person while he is in the womb of his mother. From the very get-go, this is already decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then Allah will give the person the free will. Now I will explain at the end. Because Allah knows, He knows what you will choose, but you're not imposed to do it. And I will give you an example, inshallah, at the end, which should clarify if there's still any misconception. Fourthly, the annual taqdeer, which is on Laylatul Qadr. Sahih? فِيهَا يُفْرَقُ كُلُّ أَمْرٍ حَكِيمٍ. There in that night, a decree of every matter of ordainment is done. On that night, the decree of the year, what will happen to each one of us according to that year, Hijri year, is decreed on Laylatul Qadr. On Laylatul Qadr, the affairs of the year. Then you move on a step and you go to the Taqdeer al-Yawmi. كُلَّ يَوْمٍ huwa fi sha'n. Every day Allah Azza wa Jal is subhanahu wa ta'ala is in a different different affair. Every day He's bringing something forth. The matters are different with Allah. Whoever is in the heaven and the earth, yas'aluhu man fi samawati wal ard. Kulla yawmin huwa fi sha'n. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained the ayah. Every day he has a matter to bring forth. He may forgive a sin of someone, lift and honor some, relieve the hardship of some, and so on and so forth. So every day people are going up and down. The matters of their daily life are being decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the taqdeer of every day. So we have the 150,000 years, and then we have the one of the lifespan, and the one of the and the preserved tablet. Then we have the one of the annual, and the one for the daily. All of this has been pre-decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thirdly, Allah's mashi'a. Allah's mashi'a is of two kinds. Al-mashi'a al-kawniya wal-mashi'a al-shar'iyya. The will of Allah is of two kinds. Universal and legislative. And if we understand each independently, our problems concerning misunderstandings of qadr are solved. What does universal mean? Meaning what happens in this universe. Allah willed it, but it doesn't mean Allah loves it. Everything which happens in this world happened per Allah's universal will, but that does not mean that Allah loves it. Right or wrong? Right. Does Allah love sins? Does He love kufr? Does He want people to disbelieve? No. But did Allah will it? Yes. Because if Allah didn't will it, it would never happen. If Allah didn't will it, it will never happen. This is why the scholars say this is the universal will. Meaning Allah willed that these things happen, we said earlier, for wisdom. So that the people will be tested. So people can earn paradise. And those who deserve Jahannam will go to Jahannam. This is the test in the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. This is the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah willed them to happen, but it doesn't mean that Allah loves them. Otherwise, we will fall into the issue of the Jabariya, who said that everything you do, Allah must love. No. What Allah willed that He loves is al-mashi'a al-shar'iyya, the legislative will of Allah, the commandments of Allah which you get from the Quran and the Sunnah. Aqimu salah, atu zakah, i'malu saliha. All of these instructions, Allah willed them legislatively. And then when you do them, it means Allah also will them universally. Otherwise, Allah will that people love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and follow him, but He didn't will it universally. Otherwise, everyone would have done it. People say, I don't want to love the Messenger of Allah, waliyadu billah. And how do people not really love him? Not by saying that, otherwise they will leave Islam, by not following his sunnah. A classical example of not truly loving him is abandoning his sunnah. So we have two kinds of wills. Al-mashi'a al-kawniya, that everything which Allah willed, and it doesn't mean that Allah loves it. وَلَا يَرْضَ لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفُرِ. Allah says, He's not pleased with disbelief for His slaves. He's not pleased with it. He didn't will it legally, legislatively, but He willed it universally. As for the good deeds, Allah willed it legislatively. When you do salah, let's say you prayed. Did you get one of the two wills or both? Both. You've carried out Allah's legislative will, who told you to do salah, and when you actually carry out the salah, you've done Allah's universe. Allah willed it universally. Otherwise, Allah commanded you to do salah and you sleep. Which means what? You've abandoned the legislative, but the universal one applied to you. Allah willed it that you don't wake up for a reason which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah knows. So this should be understood in the right context, otherwise people will go astray. And the last but not least, the creation of Allah. Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of everything subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything which Allah created, He created with perfect wisdom. Allah created it with justice. So nothing whatsoever happens except that Allah created even the deeds. Ibrahim alayhi salatu salam, when he was debating with the idol worshippers, he said to them, Wallahu khalaqakum wa ma ta'amaloon. Allah created you and all that which you do. So the deeds of the people are the creation of Allah. This is a refutation against the Qadariyah who say that the deeds are the creation of the people. No, even the deeds are the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We willed them after Allah willed them. And even when Allah willed them first, Allah did not force anyone to do something which is not good. The people themselves chose that. Otherwise, Allah Azza wa Jal gave us the free will. Now let me tell you something. I will give you an example, which inshallah should put things in the right order. Let's say you still fail to understand these four aspects of the belief in Qadr. How does one understand? There's still a conflict, and this question has been asked tens of times, hundreds of times. Akhi, I'm confused. On the one hand, you say that Allah decreed everything. And on the other hand, you say, I have the free will. Okay? You say, you tell me that Allah decreed whether I'm going to Jannah or Jahannam, then you tell me that I have the free will. But if Allah already decreed, how do I have the free will? How do I harmonize? How do I bring a relationship between these two issues? Let me give you a worldly example, which inshallah will help you put things in the right perspective. Tayyib, how? You have a boss. I've given that example before, but maybe some of you don't know it. You have a boss. You're an employee. He comes and he says to you, whatever your name is, Fulan, Omar, for example, I'm going to keep a close eye on you for 1 week. And after this 1 week, I will either promote you to the general manager of this business, or I will fire you. Fair enough? Give you an ultimatum. 1 week of close observation. I'm going to be keeping an eye on, I'm going to watch you, see what you're going to do. And after 1 week, it's up to me. Okay, he has the free will, doesn't he? He's the boss. If I want, I will promote you. If I want, I will fire you. And you have no say in it whatsoever. طيب. Now this is not a very pleasing situation, even though you may utilize it properly. Whatever. What are you supposed to do? Truthfully speaking, if you come the next day, 1 hour late, with your pajamas, okay? And you come and you sit on the chair like this, and you put your feet on the desk, okay? And the other employees walk in, and look at you, man, what are you doing, man? Say, it's boss. Terrible person. Why? What happened? He gave me 1 week. He said 1 week he will observe me. He will keep a close eye on me. And then he said he will either promote me or he will fire me. This is crazy, man. What is this? He's putting me in this predicament. It's really tough. What are the people going to say to you? You're crazy, man. You know what's going to happen to you now? What will happen to him? He will definitely fire him. Yani the boss may have, he wanted to test him. He wanted him to work hard, okay? The boss may have decided, I'm going to promote this guy anyway, but I want him to feel that he earned the promotion. I want him to give me his, utmost, the best he has, before I promote him. Maybe this is his mentality. And he didn't want to give it to you, on a golden platter. He wanted to kind of, make you work for it. But when he comes in and you're chilling like this, what is he going to do? He's going to fire you. 100%. What are you supposed to do? Work hard. Even if he didn't give you a promotion, why were you hired? When you were hired, to wear a pajama, come 1 hour late, drink tea, and put your feet on the desk? No. Your contract with him from the beginning is what? I do work, you give me money. Isn't this the contract we have with the people who hire us? So regardless of this ultimatum which he gave you, as an employee, you're supposed to work hard. And doing otherwise is dumb. It's feeble-mindedness. So you were supposed to work hard anyways, man. If he fires you afterwards, whose fault is it? It's his fault. We say he's a lunatic. I'm a great employee. I worked even harder at the last week. The last week, and then he still fired me. This guy is unfair. But if he promotes you, then you surely deserve the promotion. So that we were created to understand this in very basic words. If you were invited to do good or to do your obligation, you're supposed to do your obligation. And if you do otherwise, you are wrong and you can't blame the boss. You can't say, well, he told me that he may fire me. Yeah, but he told you he may promote you too. If you get fired and you try to blame him, the immediate answer is, my friend, but he gave you two choices. You chose this one. Had you done your job, you will still be in the danger zone. But now you've guaranteed failure. And to Allah belongs the highest and the best example. Ikhwan, Allah created the heavens and the earth. He created Jannah and Jahannam. And He revealed scriptures. And He commanded all of us, all of His slaves, do good, believe, do good, I will put you in Jannah. Disbelieve or do bad, I will put you in Jahannam. As someone who doesn't know what will happen, what are you supposed to do? Do good. Now the boss may oppress you. Will Allah oppress you? Never. End of story. End of story. When you don't know the future, you have no right to use it to justify your wrongdoing. No one can say, well, you know, maybe Allah took it, I'm going to go to Jahannam, so let me do whatever. No. You don't know what Allah... Now? You don't know what Allah decreed for you. You have... Why are you assuming bad about Allah? On the other hand, assume best about Allah. There's no way on earth, no way on earth, no way on earth or in the heavens that you will believe in Allah the way He wants you to believe. You will do righteous deeds while being sincere to Him. There's no way you will go to Jahannam. It's as simple as that. Because Allah promised that if you do what He wants, now you may appear to be believing and doing righteous deeds while we have other sins which will put us in Jahannam. That's a different story. If we live per the rules and the commandments, there's no way Allah will wrong you and put you in Jahannam. So now no one can use this as an excuse. No one can use it as an excuse for the future. You may use Qadr as an excuse for the past, because there's a sahih hadith. There's a sahih hadith that Musa said to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, you know why? Because of you, we were taken out of Jannah after Allah created you with His hands and this. So he tried to use this qadr and he tried to use this hujjah against Adam. Adam said to him alayhi salatu wasalam, are you blaming me? Are you going to blame me for something which Allah decreed upon me from the beginning? So the ulama say, because of this hadith, if you had done something in the past which you have repented from, let's say you used to be a musician, or used to be a thief, then you repented. If someone says, how were you a thief, man, before? Woe to you. Say, akhi, khalas, I've repented, Allah decreed it, you may use it then. But not for the future, and not for any other reason. That's what the ulama deduce from the hadith of Adam and Musa, alayhima salatu wassalam. The ultimate solution is, because we don't know what Allah has decreed, and Allah gave us two paths, one leading to Jannah and one leading to Jahannam. No one has the right to do the things which lead to Jahannam, then say, this is what Allah decreed for me. And use the Qadr of Allah as an excuse. Rather, now that we've been given both choices, you must go where Allah told you to go, and you must avoid what Allah told you to avoid. Why? You don't know whether your seat is in Jannah or Jahannam. So on what basis are you trying to be? You don't know. But we know one thing, Allah is just. If you do what Allah wants you to do, you know where you're going to end up. Isn't that easy? It's easy. And everyone has to believe firmly in Qadr, ya akhwan. It's not something which you say, okay, we don't deal, we don't discuss, I want to play it safe. No, we must understand Qadr as understood by our righteous predecessors. They had firm belief that everything was decreed by Allah. Jaffat al-suhuf, the pages have dried. The qalam has been lifted and everything which happened, Allah decreed. But subhanAllah, this is because of Allah's vast knowledge. We don't know it, but we were given a free will. What is the will? You want to do salah, you can go do salah. You want to sit down, you can sit down. No one forces you to pray and no one forces you to sit down. It is something that we will. But whether you get up to pray or you sit down, who knows it? Allah. Who knows how many good deeds you will do in your life and how many bad deeds? Allah. Because Allah knows in this ultimate way, then He knows where we will wind up. However, we don't know, so we strive for Jannah and we strive to avoid Jahannam. This is in brief what we need to understand concerning the subject matter of Qadr, which is the sixth pillar of Iman. And so, to answer the question of the title of the lecture, do I have a choice? Yes. Yes, every person in this world has a choice to enter into Islam and make it to Jannah, or to reject Islam and go to Jahannam. And for every Muslim has a choice to believe and obey Allah and His Messenger and go to Jannah, or to reject and disobey Allah and His Messenger and bear the consequences of possibly going to Jahannam. This is ultimately the truth which we learn from the Quran and the Sunnah and the understanding of the righteous predecessors. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد. Questions related to the subject matter only. Yes. عليكم السلام. بارك الله فيك. أيوة. Allah says نبلوكم بالشر ابتلاء. Meaning Allah will test you through good and through evil. It doesn't mean that Allah will create evil. What we said was, we don't attribute evil to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't say this evil is from Allah. What comes from Allah is good. People may make it evil by their misapplication, misusage, or whatever. But even in that evil which the people do, there's still goodness in it. So nablukum is ibtila. We know already that everything which exists, the existence of Iblis is a test. And we say that Iblis is evil, but not in the ultimate sense. And we don't say that evil is from Allah. Rather, we say that the byproduct of the existence of this creation creates a form of evil, and it creates good as well. So the ayah is just speaking about the human being undergoing examination throughout their life. Meaning, when Allah gives you something good, you're being tested. Are you going to utilize it and be thankful to Allah? And when something evil happens to you, ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِي النَّاسِ لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Corruption, evil has appeared on the land and in the sea because of what the people have earned with their hands. So the evil is because of what we earned with our hands. Still, Allah is testing us with that. لَعَلَّهُمْ يرجعون, perhaps they will return to Allah. So in the existence of this evil, people return to Allah, which is what? Good. So this is the ayah speaking about the existence of things which are ultimately tests. Good things happen to you, you're thankful to Allah, that's good. What appears to be evil happens to you, and it's a test from Allah to see whether you will return to Him or not. Good question. This is what Al-Imam Al-Tahawi says, this is Sirru Al-Qadr, meaning this is the limitation which I spoke about earlier, and I didn't want to elaborate on it. As in, no one can come and say, why did Allah create in Jahannam, and why did Allah decree people for Jahannam, and why did Allah create Iblis, and why? These are questions which Muslims don't ask. I know you intend good, and I'm not attacking you here, but this is where we stop, because we don't know things that Allah knows. Allah is the wise. Allah is the all-knowing. Allah is the just. There are limits where we say, khalas, you just have to stop. You're here, you make it to Jannah. Knowing this makes no difference. You see what I'm saying? So had it been important, the Messenger of Allah alayhi salam would have taught the Sahaba. Once they left these matters alone, we also leave these matters alone. Nah. So, Zakum Allah khair. Please visit onewaytoparadise.net. onewaytoparadise.net. Support the website. A lot of work has been done on it by brothers Zakum khair who are doing this for the sake of Allah. They're spending their money, they're spending their time, they're spending their effort, their skills to develop the site and make it practical and you know, friendly, user-friendly. And alhamdulillah, to a large extent, it has become like that. So don't let that effort go to waste. You know, download the classes. This matter of Aqeedah, there are maybe 7 or 8 different files on the website on the Aqeedah classes dealing with Qadr, with a much more extensive explanation from Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala. So, you know, download the files, familiarize yourself with the site, the khutbah translation. These lectures, all of them are available. Share them with your friends. Try to, you know, get a share of the whole thing so we can all, inshallah, get the reward if Allah Azza wa Jal accepts our humble deeds. جزاكم الله خير واخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته.